Our scripture reading this morning comes from the book of Ezra, which is in the study that book this morning, chapter 3. When the seventh month came, and the Israelites were in their towns, the people gathered together in Jerusalem. Then Jeshua, with his fellow priests and relatives, set out to build the altar of God of Israel, to offer burnt offerings on it, as prescribed in the law of Moses, the man of God. From the last day of the seventh month, they began to offer burnt offerings to the Lord, but the foundation of the temple of the Lord was not yet laid. So they gave money to the masons and the carpenters, and food and drink and oil to the Sidonians and the Tyrians, to bring cedar trees from Lebanon to the sea, to Joppa, according to the grant that they had from King Cyrus of Persia. In the second year after their arrival at the house of God at Jerusalem, in the second month, the people made a beginning, the priests and the Levites, and all who had come to Jerusalem from the captivity. When the builders laid the foundation of the temple of the Lord, the priests in their vestments were stationed to praise the Lord with trumpets, and the Levites with cymbals, according to the directions of King David of Israel. And they sang responsibly, praising and giving thanks to the Lord, for God is good, for God's steadfast love endures forever. And all the people responded with a great shout when they praised the Lord, because the foundation of the house of the Lord was laid. But many of the priests and Levites and heads of families, old people who had seen the first house on its foundations, wept with a loud voice when they saw this house, though many shouted aloud for joy, so that the people could not distinguish the sound of the joyful shout from the sound of the people's weeping, for the people shouted so loudly that the sound was heard far away. Please remain seated and join Stephanie in the singing of our prayer of illumination, which is in the bulletin.
Well, good morning, everybody.
Good morning.
For those who are visiting us today, I know you're really here for this main event, but I thought it would just be nice to try and catch you up on our church's study over the summer. We are, as you know, in the middle of our 125th anniversary year. Woo! We're very excited. And we're at the very beginning of a campaign to raise enough money to build an elevator. You get up those stairs. Wouldn't that be nice? It would be very nice. But yeah, we're trying. So we've decided this summer, as we prepare for a building project, to look back at our heritage as Christians, to learn about how it's also part of our heritage to be builders. So we've been studying the book of Ezra. It is very exciting.
Yes.
Good, okay. We also Ezra begins with this edict from King Cyrus of Persia. He is the guy who has recently taken over Babylon. Now, Babylon had been kind of a major power in the region, and about 40 years ago, they had conquered Israel. Their strategy for ruling a conquered nation was to destroy institutions and homes. They wrecked the temple in Jerusalem, and they took the influential people away to live in exile, in captivity, and then leaving some of their own people in the land to kind of keep things in order, right? So King Cyrus of Persia, when he becomes the power in the area, has a different plan. He thinks the best way to get taxes and tributes out of the conquered people is to be a little bit nice to them, to support them. And so this edict comes from King Cyrus of Persia that the people of Israel should return to their homes, should go back and rebuild their temple. And he gives them the items from the temple treasury that Babylon had carried away, and he tells their neighbors that they should give whatever they can to support their project. So last week we read Ezra chapter 2, which if you've ever started to read the book of Ezra, you probably stopped there, because it's one of those lists of names chapters. Yeah, such and such, who got so-and-so, and the father of these, yeah, really mad. It's more than a list of names, though. It is a list of a community's resources. It's a list of the people who are going home with them to do this new building project. It's a list of the history that they're taking forward into the future. And we looked at a list of our own names here, the people who built this place 125 years ago, the people who taught us how to live the people who proclaimed God's love and provision over generations. This community, as with that ancient Israelite community, journeys with us, giving us strength and inspiration for our future. So that should pretty much catch you up to where we are today when we read Ezra chapter 3. So the people have left exile, they've returned to their homes, and after they've had a minute to kind of settle in, they begin to work. They rebuild the altar, they hire the contractors, they send for the wood and the supplies, and they lay the foundation of the new temple. The future is shaping up, and it looks bright. Now I'm aware, as we sit here this morning, many of our big soccer fans are not in church. If you follow the World Cup, you'll know the final match, France versus Croatia, is today at 11, so that happened. Melanie Trottier Mitchison emailed this morning because she's got a whole house full of French people watching the World Cup. She can't get to church. But it's interesting if you like soccer, right?
Football.
Football, yeah, of course. I know. I have a British friend who like calls it football, and I'm like, somehow I have a bunch of friends who are very into soccer, into the World Cup. So I went with some of them to a bar last week to watch one of these matches. It was Brazil and Belgium, I think. So Brazil, I can get behind that, right? We have our Brazilian congregation here. We feel some connection. Okay. I can cheer for a team. And the game kind of goes back and forth, and to my eye, not very much happens. But people are excited by things. And at one point, I got up and went to the bathroom, and as I'm washing my hands, I hear this huge roar coming from the restaurant outside. And I got back to the table, and I asked my friends, what did I miss? What happened? Oh, I think you know, they said. But I didn't know. The thing about the sound of rejoicing fans shouting, "Go!" That sounds a lot like the sound of despairing fans shouting, "No!" And it's that scene that I thought of when I read the end of Ezra chapter 3. But many of the priests and Levites and heads of families, the old people who had seen the first temple on its foundations, wept with a loud voice when they saw this house. But many shouted aloud for joy, so the people could not distinguish the sound of the joyful shout from the sound of the people's weeping. The people shouted so loudly, the sound was heard far away. The people of God who had lived in exile had wanted nothing more than to return home. Their hearts ached for the house of God that lay in ruins. And somehow, miraculously, in a reversal of fortunes, their temple treasury had been returned to them, and here they were at long last home. They'd been away long enough that some of the elders had passed away, and among them were younger folks who'd never even lived in this place, but they had heard the stories and they had inherited their family's longing. Finally, at long last, here they were building this foundation. And the priests were finally able to celebrate properly the ceremonies that had been prohibited to them when they were so far from home. And they sang it responsively, "For God is good, for God's steadfast love endures forever." And the people could not distinguish between the sound of the joyful shout and the sound of people's weeping. Now, since we are embarking on our own building projects here, it's really not that difficult to understand this moment in the story, is it? Even now, with some of the changes we've made to the sound system, to the carpeting, some of us have rejoiced, and some of us have wept over how things used to be. It's not that one group is right and one group is wrong, or that some of us are more flexible than others, or that even we're on opposing soccer teams. It's that the future is scary, and change is hard. After we've raised all the money and the elevator is built, many of us will celebrate over the realization of a dream so long in the making. And many of us will weep for Marie and for Bob, who weren't ever able to use it. For the memories of Bible studies in the parlor that would become the elevator shaft. For another time, for when we were young, for when people we loved were still with us, for something that we had lost. Some Bible scholars are uncomfortable with this moment in Ezra. So much so, our friend Eugene Peterson, remember we read this translation of the Romans last year. In his paraphrase, he adds some words in and says that elders were crying for joy. I don't think that's true. They remembered the way that things used to be. Maybe they had regrets. Maybe they were thinking through the what ifs, second guessing the way that they had lived. Maybe they wondered if it was even worth it to try at all. Out of these feelings of insecurity, of wounded hope, of grief, they wept. Friends, the future will always be unknown, and change will always be hard. But that's not the whole story, is it? This morning, we, like those priests and Levites, will commit ourselves to the celebration of a sacred ritual. We will baptize Miriam and Lorraine, welcoming them into the family of faith, and committing to walk with them no matter what the future holds. We cannot know how the future will turn out. We cannot know how things will be. We cannot please everyone or do everything perfectly. We're only human. What we can do is return to the foundations of our faith. Hope that something good lies ahead. Confidence that we are loved and capable of loving. Relief in the grace of God that redeems us from sin and evil over and over and over. Whatever the final project, if and when that elevator is finished, some of us will rejoice, and some of us may weep. In the midst of it all, we will continue to proclaim defiantly the triumph of love and mercy over hatred and sin. Whatever lies ahead, we will all still belong to one another and to God. It's the beauty of this whole thing, the church, that we are part of the body of Christ, each different and unique. And it's important that we bring those differences together. It's good. It's the way that God intended it to be. And like our ancestors, whether we weep or rejoice, we will find ourselves still part of one community. In celebration of this good news, we welcome Lorraine and Miriam into this body this morning, looking with hope for the future that God has planned. Before we sing, I would like to invite any kids or very short adults who would like to come to the front so you have a really good view of the baptism when it comes to in this row. Okay.
For everyone born, a place at the table, to live without fear, and simply to be. To work is to be God, to witness and worship. For everyone born, a right to be free. And God will delight when we are creators of justice.
Super happy to have these people here in our midst this morning. Hear the words of our Lord Jesus Christ. All authority in heaven and on earth has been given to me. Go, therefore, and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the triune God, three in one, and teaching them to obey everything that I have commanded you. Remember, I am with you always, to the end of the age. Hear also these words from Scripture. As many of you as were baptized into Christ have clothed yourself with Christ. There's been one with two or three, slave or free, male or female, for all are one in Christ Jesus. Obeying the word of God and confident of God's promises, we baptize those whom God has called. In baptism, God claims us and seals us to show us that we belong to God. God frees us from sin and death, uniting us with Jesus Christ in his death and resurrection. By water and the Holy Spirit, we are made members of the church, the body of Christ, and joined to Christ's ministry of love, peace, and justice. Let us remember with joy our own baptism as we celebrate this sacrament.
On behalf of the session, I present Meagan Dickinson and Lorraine Craig Dickinson, daughters of Devin Dickinson, to receive the sacrament of baptism.
David and Devin, do you desire that Lorraine and Meagan be baptized?
I do.
Relying on God's grace, do you promise to live the Christian faith and to teach that faith to your children?
I do.
To all of our godparents, Shelby, Amanda, and Chris, Katie, Angie, and Jeremy, do you promise, through prayer and example, to support and encourage Meagan and Lorraine to be faithful Christians?
We do.
So we have a special opportunity for everyone in our congregation to say we're going to support these two. And the ones who are closest might be our own children. So I'm going to ask you guys if you would like to say some words about how you're going to support these babies. And Michelle has some questions she wants to ask. So she can ask you some questions, and if you want to say yes, we'll say we will. Okay? I'll help you.
I am becoming part of the church family. We are all God's children. These pledges are for us, the children of the church. Each time you say we will, you make a promise to God and to Meagan and Lorraine. Will we help Meagan and Lorraine remember the God them and we love them?
We will.
Will we share the stories of Jesus and Meagan and Lorraine?
Our whole congregation, to you as members of the Church of Jesus Christ, promise to guide and nurture Lorraine and Meagan by word and deed, with love and prayer, encouraging them to know and follow Christ, and to be faithful members of this church. If so, say, we do.
We do.
Through baptism, we enter into the covenant that God has established. God gives us new life, guards us from evil, and nurtures us in love. So David and Devin, as God embraces you within the covenant, I ask you to reject sin, to profess your faith in Christ Jesus, and to confess the faith of the church in which we baptize. Trusting in the gracious mercy of God, do you turn from the ways of sin and renounce evil and its power in the world? Do you turn to Jesus Christ and accept him as your Lord and Savior, trusting in his grace and love? Will you be Christ's faithful disciples, obeying his word and showing his love? With the whole church, let us confess our faith. I believe in
God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, God's only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day,
the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting.
gracious God, pour out your Spirit upon us and upon this water, that it may be a fountain of deliverance at my birth. May the ones who now pass through these waters be delivered from death to life, from bondage to freedom. Bind them to the household of faith. Guard them from all evil. Strengthen them to serve you with joy until the day you make all things new. To you be all praise, honor, and glory through Jesus Christ, our Savior, who lives and reigns forever.
Gracious God, giver of all life, we pray for David and Devin, parents of Lorraine and Miriam. Give them wisdom and patience to guide their children in the way of Jesus Christ and the faith of the Church.
Let your peace and joy dwell in your home, that their family life may be instructed by faith, sustained by prayer, and governed by life. Strengthen them in their own baptism, that they may rejoice as children of God and serve you faithfully. In the name of Jesus Christ, amen.
Quickly, before we do that, I want to invite Tanya forward. She has a special gift on behalf of all of us. Here are the baptismal certificates.
With joy and thanksgiving, we welcome you into Christ's church to share with us in his ministry, for we are all one in Christ.
Praise, 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 praise,
all sing two songs with five voices this morning. We've got a few announcements. If you want to sit down, if it's easier to not sit down, that's fine. Okay. 2 weeks from today, a congregational meeting for the purpose of voting on next steps for selling of the manse. If you are not going to be here, we will figure out some way for you to give your vote, so let me know. Melanie is still working on the Narcan training workshop. It's a drug you can give to a person to stop them from overdosing. It's free to learn how to use it, but she needs two more people to sign up in order for the workshop to go ahead. So please let me know if you are going to be there on Tuesday. Toys still?
Toys still available. Please check the second room on the right across from the counting room. There's a picture on the door of the toys that are available. A few things were taken last week, so that was awesome. But there's still selection there, so if you're interested.
And please check with your parents first before you decide to take any.
So as you know, September 29th, we're having a big party to celebrate our 125th anniversary. You're all invited. All of our guests are here today. Please come. We'd love to have you. On the back table are invitations. So if you've been waiting to receive your invitation, here it is. If there are some people you would like to invite, you can send it out to them. I, yesterday, addressed a bunch of these to my family who lives in Ohio. They're not going to come. But I put a little self-addressed envelope in for their check. There's a little note back there too if you want to put it in. Because I'm serious, what we have here is special. What we have here is unique, and God is doing a thing. And I want people to be invited into supporting that. To update you, we have a goal of $12,500 to be raised by the end of September. As of last week, we've surpassed it. But through a gift from Bob and Sue and through another anonymous gift, we have been given a $9,000 challenge. So that's $9,000 that we will only get if we can raise another $9,000. Okay? Are you with me? Can we do it?
Yes.
That's why I put the envelopes with the letters. Yeah. And I think that our goal, the goal we had in the back of our minds since the beginning of this planning was $125,000. But maybe we'll go from $25,000 by the end of September. I think we can do it. Do you think we can do it?
Yes.
God is good?
All the time. God is good.
Friends, let us go in peace to love and serve God and to love and serve potluck food downstairs.
How about grace?
May God bless the hands who have prepared the food. May God bless all who partake in it. We give God thanks and praise for the abundance that awaits us. Amen?
Amen.